So good afternoon, everyone. I hope my voice is clear to all and my screen is visible. Please give me a confirmation.
Yes.
Okay, great. So we'll start with the session. I'll start with my introduction. Myself, Rupesh, I'm the digital strategist working with Synergetics. Welcome to you all for today's session. So before moving ahead with our webinar, I would like to give a small introduction about Synergetics Learning, who's the one of the sponsors of today's webinar. So Synergetics caters to a very niche segment of corporate solutions and learning. It offers IT technology solutions to organizations, companies, and enterprises, along with training their IT team in implementing and operating this solution so that they stay ahead of the competition. Apart from group training, we also specialize in providing training for Microsoft certifications and ensure every IT professional excels in today's competitive IT world. So presenting a brief overview of a master solution offered by Synergetics are onboarding solution, reskilling solution, Microsoft certification solution, certification plus add-on solution, cloud adoption, architecting, practice playbook, latest technology training and emerging technology training. So today's session is organized by Azure Tech Community, that is the ATC community, and sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. So professionals who are interested in today's latest technologies, like IoT, cloud, DevOps, they can follow our communities on Meetup. So basically, Meetup is an application that you have to download on your phone and you have to search for our communities that are there. So we have created city-based communities. Like for Pune people, we have created Azure Tech Community Pune. For Surat people, Gujarat people, we have created Surat Emerging Technology Community. People who are interested in AI platforms, we have created AI community for them. For Nagpurkers, we have created Azure Tech Community Nagpur. And other than that, for the common other cities, we have created emerging technology community. So you guys, you can just download this application in your phone and search for this community and you can follow us so that you will be updated about our future webinars, meetups, events, workshops. So this is a small code of conduct. Please note that you cannot take a screenshot of a presentation and you cannot do the screen recording. One more thing I want to add in today's session, that recently we have faced a little incident that in a recent webinar, one of a person had violated a policy. Okay, so please keep this note that, you have to join us for the sessions for learning purpose. Okay, and we have kept few limitations and policies for these sessions. So do not violate these policies, because after that, we'll be taking the strict action if any violation will be happening. So let's move ahead with the session. So our webinar, today's webinar is on Power Virtual Agent. So our agenda for the session is that we are focusing on Power Virtual Agent and processes of creating a chatbot using zero code solution. And our session takeaway is participants are going to, this session will be able to understand core elements of Power Platform and get a kickstart of Power Virtual Agent. Our speaker for this session is Mr. Om Prakash Pandey. So Om Prakash sir is highly experienced Microsoft certified trainer with decades of rich experience in technical learning and implementation consultations across India and the globe. His teaching experience spans across more than 50,000 students and 200 enterprises around the world. Currently, he is working with Synergetics as an AVP of delivery department. Now you can grow professionally by adding the latest technology skills with Microsoft various certifications. You can enroll for any of these trainings program with Synergetics, where you will be experiencing live interactive sessions with the best industry Microsoft certified trainers. Trust us and we'll deliver the best. So anyone who's interested, this is our training calendar. So anyone is interested in the mentioned training programs, they can contact me. The number will be shared in the chat box. These are the updated training programs. This is the upcoming webinar calendar for the year. So the next webinar that is happening on 7th of August for the certification, the topic will be Microsoft Azure Administrator AZ-104 certification. So anyone who's interested, they can register themselves. We are sharing the registration link in the chat box. So the next webinar for the emerging technology will be on Blade framework. So you can register for this webinar also. So we'll be sharing the registration link again. One special announcement, based on your feedbacks are very important to us. So based on your feedbacks, we are going to select five lucky winners. And these lucky winners are going to win the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers. So please do share your valuable feedbacks. And also we'll be sharing the recording of this session on our YouTube channel. So do follow our channel on YouTube. All the links will be shared. So do check that. So now I'll hand over the mic to Mr. Om Prakash, sir. So you can continue.
Thank you very much, Rupesh.
Thank you, sir.
Hello and welcome, everyone. Please confirm if you can hear me and is my screen visible to you all?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Yes, it's visible.
Thank you. Thank you very much for joining in. So in COVID scenarios, I know everybody's working to the maximum peak. And even in that scenario, you are able to sneak out time to attend new technology sessions. Thank you very much, Manish and Rupesh, for setting up this entire environment. I know after an entire hectic week, you'll have enough energy left to learn. And that's really a great thing for us. It also puts more responsibility and onus on us as trainers, that when people are committing their time on a weekend, we should be able to give maximum value to them. Thank you very much for joining in. As far as Manish and Rupesh is concerned, there are extremely motivated team members and they have put in all required information on the chat window. So if time, I would recommend everybody to go to the chat window, pick up those details, save it on Notepad, WordPad, OneNote, wherever you'd want. This is most critical information and provides all details for upcoming sessions. Any other information that one would want in terms of when will this session happen, registration details, all administrative information, right? Any information about upcoming sessions and all that details, right? Y'all can chat with Manish and Rupesh, who would be there on the chat window. As far as technical details are concerned, y'all can unmute yourself, ask those questions to me. I'll take up those questions depending upon the time that we have, because it's a 2-hour session and I have some exciting stuff packed over here, which I want everybody to go through. So welcome everyone. Let's proceed ahead. As far as Power Platform is concerned, this is something which is growing very, very rapidly. And through the registrations and through the feedback which Manish and Rupesh have been giving, that there are plenty of people, lots and lots of people who are interested in Power Platform, which is very good to hear. At times, while I was learning and I was getting into the IT world, the most common thing that people wanted to do was do programming, right? Write code, build applications. Today, what people are looking at is we need to solve more and more business problems, right? Today, we want to create more and more end user applications. at a very, very short span of time. Believe me, guys, it took us around 10 to 15 years to realize that this application programming, this code, this logic, whatever we are writing, the actual purpose behind that is to make sure people are able to solve business problems. People are able to understand and gather requirements from the customers. They are able to implement those solutions as fast as possible, build POCs, do rapid application development, and present these solutions to the customers. Right? Keeping that kind of context in mind, Power Platform is a very apt solution in that environment. If you look at Power Platform, this is a no code, zero code kind of solution, right? With minimum code that we have, we are able to implement custom solutions, right? Customer based implementations, which they are looking for, right? The most important aspect which I have learned during my career is quickly capturing feedback and converting that into feed forward, right? So here, if you want to do all these things, if you take say a month or two in terms of programming, write complex logic, all these things, right, from scratch, then suddenly you realize that customer says, no, Om Prakash, you're on wrong track. This is what I was not expecting. I was expecting something else. But again, and after taking that input again to implement that takes another 2 months. Correct? Now that is one of the difficult things which will happen, and it has happened to me quite a few times. Because customers want agility, customers want speed in terms of response, right? Now, keeping that kind of requirements in mind, Power Platform is much, much faster to implement, quicker to implement. You know what customer wants, what they don't want, right? And what we have been discussing in past in terms of rapid application development is now possible using Power Platform. And this will be in number of contexts. Now, keeping this scenario in mind, what Microsoft has done is they have provided four basic certifications over here, which you all can look at. Right. So one of the key things that you all see over here would be PL 900, which is Power Platform Fundamentals. You have PL 100, right? You have PL 300, PL 200 and PL 400. So each of these implementations are targeted towards specific audience, right? And using these implementations, it will be easier for us to understand, get these certifications done, right? So it's good to start off with PL 900, where we understand these aspects. Right, before we get into more technical details, let's understand what are the key solutions over here and whatever I have discussed with you all, how those things get implemented. As part of Microsoft Power Platform, it is based on Office 365, Azure, your Dynamics 365, and plenty of standalone applications, plenty of services which are hosted on cloud environment. Now the question over here is it actually running on which environment? Actually saying each of these are independent services. They can help you integrate with Office 365, Azure, Dynamics 365, but they are not part of any of these solutions directly, right? What are the key components over here? So if you look at the key components, like I have been mentioning about rapid application development, in terms of UI, right, which is done through Power Apps. And once you have created these solutions using Power Apps, you'll be able to show these information on number of form factors. Along with that, in terms of Power Automate, where you can create business processes, business flows, right? Plenty of mapping entities over here. Third one that you see is your Power Virtual Agents, using which you can create chatbots, right? And the fourth member that you see over here is Power BI, where you can create business reporting, right? Various analytics visualizations that you'd want to present over here, you can do it using Power BI. Now, once it comes to Power Apps, where you are starting to take inputs from the user, pass it on to Power Automate, which will do the required processing behind the scene, update number of systems, invoke or do needed set of actions behind the scene, right? You may have another way of communication, another way of interacting with the data stores using Power Virtual Agents. And finally, represent all this information using Power BI. Right? So you can create solution using these components, or you can use them independently as well. It is absolutely not a compulsion that all of these components have to go together. Okay, so you can decide whether I want to use Power Apps, whether I want to use Power BI, right? There are independent mechanisms of using them. Now the question is, how is it possible? It is made possible by using something called as data connectors, where you can connect to SQL Server, SharePoint, you can connect to Dropbox, OneDrive. So there are more than 600 plus connectors which are available within this platform, which can help you connect with number of data sources. Along with this, if I feel that I have a service and I would want that service to be used within Power BI or Power Apps or Power Automate for that matter, I can go ahead and create a custom connector for it, right? So there are a number of connectors which are already existing, and one can also go ahead and create a new custom connectors for newer data sources or new services. Another member that you see over here is your artificial intelligence. So today, when you're looking at cognitive services in terms of image recognition, right? Text conversion, right? Then Louis implementations. So there are plenty of these details which Microsoft has already been published. So how do I capitalize on those things, right? How do I build resources based on that? See, I am not a developer, I'm a Power user. So being a Power user, I would definitely want to go for a solution which is a low code or zero code kind of solution, correct? But as far as the process is concerned, that is finding a model, training a particular model. So those things which was being done programmatically, how can I do those things without writing a single line of code? That is where AI Builder comes into picture, right? So each of these components that you will see will help you provide a solution or help you work with resources which developers take good amount of time to work with, correct? And they need to install a lot of complex tools, configure them, integrate them, struggle with major versions, minor versions. So there are a lot of things that they have to do, right? In context of that, if you look at Power Platform, it's a very, very easiest way, I would say, to start with, get started with these components. And that is what makes sense, and that's what's interesting once it comes to this platform. I'm not sure how many of you all are from programming background. Here, if you all see, there is something called as data access layer. Now, before I move ahead, can I see raise of hands, people who are from programming background? I'm not saying that's a prerequisite. Okay, I can see quite a few hands being raised who are from programming background. I'm sorry, no hard feelings, because I'm going to say something which developers are struggling with, but that's a fact, because I have been a developer myself in the previous era. Okay, so what I was mentioning over here was, a lot of us have been working with data access layer, where we have been teaching, preaching, practicing that there has to be a data access layer which should be independent of whichever data source we are connecting to. The model should be consistent. Even if I change the data source behind the scene, it should not impact the UI, right? How do you implement that? So there has been various technologies which has been developed, ORM framework, entity framework, JPA, right? All these things have been simplified and made easily available by using something called as Dataverse services, right? Which gives you gives your application a standard communicating interface where you have entities, where you have relationships between those entities, right? The UI will keep working on it, devoid of the fact how this is going to connect to the database or a kind of data source in the later stages, right? So that kind of loose coupling that we have been talking about is being implemented over here by using something called as common data services or Dataverse. Now, these symbols, images, and the components you see are basic building blocks of your Power Platform. And each of them have in-depth implementation for these resources. If you see the sequence of how these things have evolved, first came Power BI, because people are looking for replacement for SSRS as a service, right? Publicly available on cloud. Then came Power Apps. Then we had Microsoft Flow, which later got renamed as Power Automate, right? And at the last, we had Power Virtual Agents, where more and more people have been asking, how can we build chatbot solutions without having to write too much of code, which people do using Node.js or .NET or Java, right? Along with that, how do we leverage upon so many data sources which we have, correct? How do I work with artificial intelligence and latest technologies, again, without using a lot of coding solutions there? Now, keeping this context in mind, let's proceed ahead. Let me quickly brief you all about these things, each of these members, and then we'll jump onto the bandwagon of Power Virtual Agents. How do they work and what are the options available inside that? Now, first resource that you'll see, what people have been expecting is, how do I create a UI which is independent of various form factors? Correct? Now, keeping that requirement in mind, here what you have is a highly customized role-based canvas applications, right? Which can connect to multiple data sources behind the scene, pull data from various sources, and make sure you have a fully immersive model-driven applications. And the UI that you see over here is responsive UI, which generally people would do using Angular, React, Seneca, Molecular, right? And a lot of other Node.js based technologies. So keeping that kind of requirement in mind, here we can simplify this process. We can create these resources by using a simple solution that is called as Power Apps. So I'm sure you'll have been through some of the videos which is being shared by Manish and team. If not, you all can go to our YouTube channel. We have plenty of details in terms of Power Apps, right? Before I move ahead, I would want to share a link with all of you all, which is PL900, Microsoft Certified Professionals. You can do MCP over here. You can get your certifications. If you look at this course, this is primarily about the component that I just mentioned. It is Microsoft Dataverse, working with Power Apps, respective labs over here. Moving ahead with Power Automate, Power BI, and finally, a quick introduction to Power Virtual Agents. Right? Let me share this link with you all. So whenever you all have time, you all can go through more details of it. For registration on this entire complete session for PL900, you all can send your request to Manish and team. This is a 2-day session. with complete hands on. I was mentioning about Power Apps. So if you look at the solutions within Power Apps, you will be able to see series of applications which has been built just to make sure our participants understand what is this entire environment all about, how does it work, right? So if you look at your application app creation over here, as part of Power App fundamentals, we are only covering one aspect of it, which is Canvas apps. But if you look at other options available, you have model driven apps, and you have you also have something called as portal apps. Right? So depending upon respective requirements of organizations, you can build any of these resources over here. You can make use of a portal app, Canvas app. In terms of data words that we have been mentioning about, tables, choices, data flows, custom connectors, these are a part of your Power Apps platform. Right? Same set of resources will also be available for Power Automate. So once it comes to Power Apps, you can build number of solutions over here, number of app types, which I mentioned to you all. Most commonly used solution over here is your Canvas apps. Let me log into this environment. You all need to give me a minute more. There's an authenticator app associated with it. Okay, so once done, let me proceed further. Okay, so this is the kind of application you can build, where you have multi-model or data coming from number of sources, right? And you can showcase all this related information within a given single screen. So you have the design mode over here. This is the design mode, and this is the execution mode. So once this Power Apps have been created, you can share it within your organization to other team members. They can work with these resources. And this is the entire environment where you can add more set of components depending upon what is your requirement in terms of AI builder, in terms of mixed reality, right? Whatever icons you want to use over here, whatever media components you want to use in terms of microphone, maps, right? Microsoft Stream, video communications. So from a device perspective, whatever recent resources are required, all this information or all these, components you'll have over here. Simple drag and drop, create your resources in whichever way you'd want to, map it to your data source and get working with it. So this is the kind of flexibility that you have. Now, many of them, when I show this environment, get put off saying that there is so many other environments where you have rich UI controls, this, that. Okay. If you want to create those kind of controls, you can create them as well. You have options of creating custom controls over here also, right? So don't get worried on that. So when that possibilities are available over here. So what Microsoft has given right now is whatever are basic components and most used components today. if people want more resources, they would want to create more components, they can work with it. And there are a lot of readily available templates which y'all can work with, right? So whenever users start working with it, or whenever people start working with a new environment, they would want to explore what is the possibility here. How can I go and create a small hello world kind of thing? Here you don't have to do hello world, right? Here you can take up a complete application and publish that. See how it works. And there is a possibility that if you have some idea in mind, there is an application 60 to 70% closer to that. That makes you can relate to it very quickly. And that's the core purpose of creating these resources here. This is a quick look in terms of what is possible with Power Apps. Second member that you see over here is your Power Automate as an environment. As part of Power Automate, here, what you can do is you can create something called as flows over here, where using which you can automate your business model. Now, many a times, even I was confused, why would somebody do this? When I already have my programming logic, I have so many programming languages, .NET, Java, and Python, right? There are so many programming languages which I have. So why would I go for a Power Automate or a kind of workflow environment? So if you go back in history, even if we had those kind of programming languages, integration technologies, workflow based technologies, workflow runtime, these things existed for a very, very long time. Correct? Because there would definitely be requirements where people would not want to where people would want to execute a piece of code or a piece of workflow for much, much longer duration, right? It would interact with human beings, right? At times, it will interact with other systems, other processes, invoke them, wait for them, right? If one approach fails, right, or workflow branch fails, it should go back to the second option for that, right? So finding out number of mechanisms of completing the workflow, right? So there has been such kind of implementations in past as well, whether you look at enterprise service bus, or you look at on number of orchestrations using BizTalk, correct? Now, how do I make it reachable to a normal user? That was a major, major challenge with Microsoft. Correct? So people who are small enterprises or small businesses, right, where who have processes, right, they are not looking for year-long workflow, at least for a month-long workflow or a 15-day kind of workflow storage and creation. How do I make it reachable to these kind of people? And that's what Power Automate is all about. So integrating with Word, Excel, PowerPoint, OneDrive, helping users to work with other office components, integrate with them, integrating with third-party services, right? So that is what Microsoft was looking for. And they have made it available. They have made it possible by using Power Automate environment. Here, you have a simple event-driven mechanism. And this event could be your email event, could be a file being put onto OneDrive, right? Or you can initiate one of the resources over here by using your HTTP request, right? Or it could be a button flow. Now, what is this button flow? In sense, you can invoke it by using a mobile device as well. So you decide how do you want to invoke these Power Automate solutions, or how do you want to invoke these workflows? Now, another question that one could have in mind is, Omprakash, all these things are happening on cloud. What about my on-premises application? I have done so much of investment there. I have my CRM or ERP solutions. which I can't move to cloud. Not to worry. With Power BI, some of you all might have already tried it out. So you have something called as on-premises data gateway, right? And using these gateway solutions, you can connect to your on-premises environment. You can connect with your on-premises environment. You can connect with your CRM, SharePoint, SQL Server, or in any such data source that you have or data store that you have within your on-premises environment, and you can work with them, right? If I go to Power Automate, here you'll be able to see similar to your Power Apps environment. Here also you'll be able to see number of pre-existing templates. Now, one of the best part which I like about these environments would be environments is, I'm not sure how many of you have began with this earlier or seen these earlier. We hardly had say 10 to 15 templates, and same templates was being organized or being shown in 20 different sections. And then I was surprised. I was really surprised how I would go and implement these things. Sorry, guys. But now if you see and way how the, and this also proves how the adoption of resources have increased. How adoption of Power Automate has increased and so many options available. You'll realize that there are many of them which are not part of Microsoft solutions, which are part of third party solutions or pre-existing services which are available on internet. Right? But you can create your solutions, you can create automation options using them. Okay, so this is what is making sense for number of people across the industry. Something like executing SQL stored procedure on recurring basis, copying data from Smartsheet to Excel online for business, working with FTP server. Now, believe me, at times, whenever I have a customer requirement on hand, I go and check for this. I definitely find 5 to 10 scenarios which I can resolve by just picking up a pre-existing template. If I already have some of my customer requirements, right, and I don't find a template for it, I can go ahead, create my own flow and save it as a template, which I can reuse it in future. So there are a number of options that we have over here using these templates. As far as flow is concerned, there we discussed about three types of apps. Canvas apps were the first one. Second type of apps that you have is model-driven apps, right? And the third one that you have is the third one that we have over here is your Power Apps portal, right? Now, if you go to Power Automate, the number of options over here is much more. Options here that you see is much more. Here you have automated cloud flows, which is the most largest category over here. Then you have your instant cloud flows, which is also called as button flows. Then you have your scheduled cloud flows, which is executing a flow based on a recurring schedule. You want to execute it once in a day, twice in a day, once in a week, once in a month, right? So you can have a scheduled cloud flow for that. You have your desktop flows over here, which is a very, very important resource for RPA. Right? So you can have your desktop flows, which is running on your on-premises environment, and that would be initiated by a trigger, which is on cloud. Then you have your business process flows, which integrates very, very closely with your Dynamics 365. So if you see, there are a series of scenarios which I have created over here, invoking third-party service, like a weather forecast service, extracting text from images, which is using an AI builder, working with SharePoint environment. Whenever a new item is created, I want to start an approval process, right? Getting a push notification when I receive an email, which is using button flows. Anyone, any question? Yes, Atenan, go ahead.
Hello, nothing now, Prakash, actually. I raised it all earlier.
Okay, okay, no problem. So if you look at the options over here, so as part of the 2-day course that I was talking about, this is what we discuss about. How do you invoke an RPA, which is a desktop flow within your on-premises environment, by establishing a gateway, right? So there are a number of things that one can do by using these resources available within your Power Automate environment. Then I mentioned about desktop flows, business process flows. How do you perform these actions and activities over here? If you look at shared with me basically would mean I have created a Power Automate workflow, and I want other members also to invoke the same, correct? Or I'm developing a workflow, I want to share it with other team members as well within my organization. That is the same concept which applies to apps, right? Shared apps and shared flows as well. Now, if you look at the other components over here in terms of connectors, in terms of AI builder, those things will be common to your Power Apps. Those things will be common to your Power Automate as well, right? So you can go ahead, create a custom connector over here, and you'll realize I showed the same details in Power Apps as well, because these are the foundational aspect of it. There has been, in most of my sessions which I have been doing, most of them have been talking about how about DevOps solutions over here, how do I create different kind of environments over here, right? Staging environment, production environment, right? So same set of principles which hold true for DevOps, how those things will get applied over here. When you say no code solution, are you also mentioning that whatever best practices we have in terms of creating and organizing applications, those things we'll have to leave behind? No, it's nothing of that sort. Here, if you see under the solutions section, I have number of pre-existing solutions created, right? And within a given solution, I can add plenty of components over here. I can add a chatbot, I can add organization settings, custom API, catalog, I can add reports over here, different type of flows I would want, right? Apps which I would want to add over here, or dashboard which I want to create. So there are number of options which you can, number of components that you can add within a solution. So once you have your solution being created, you can export your solution. And in very similar way, you may also import the solution from the pre-created environment, right? That is an advantage that we have, or I would say that is how your DevOps will be managed over here, right? So you can organize the resources, organize the components properly. So this was a quick look in terms of Power Automate and what they are meant to do. From Power BI perspective, right? For Power BI, you can go ahead, create your visualizations. Now, before I proceed ahead, can I see raise of hands, people who have worked with Power BI? Okay, so Deepak, Vishwa. That's great. So I can see plenty of people who have, around 7 of them, who have already worked with Power BI. So they would know what is Power BI all about. So like how I have been talking about custom components within Power Apps. Similarly, you have custom visuals or custom visualizations in Power BI as well. But once it comes to Power BI, it is a very, very important resource from people who are not from too much of data background or programming background, but they know how do you show the data in terms of visualization to the end user in such a way that they can make business decisions based on that. Now, business decisions are very, very critical. They have to be, these kind of decisions have to be taken in a speedy manner so that we don't, correct? But you cannot wait for a designer team or a developer team to create business reports, number of SQL DBAs, to get that data converted from one format to second format. So all these kind of, what do you say, timelines which you have, we have very, very strict timelines over here. So these kind of things are very critical for people and organizations which have to take decisions. They would want to use something called a self-service BI. Right? I would want to decide on my own which of these parameters, which of these fields are relevant for me. And how do I showcase all these resources here? Many a times, now earlier, what was happening is people were working with a lot of historical data. And in today's context, most of this information or most of the analysis that people would want to do would be on live data rather than historical data. Correct? So whenever you have these kind of requirements, Power BI is there for rescue, where it provides you all these important resources and it will help you to work with these members over here. If you look at your Power BI over here, so you have your Power BI desktop and you have your Power BI resources available via app.powerbi.com. Which is this environment. Okay, the same environment. So here, if you see, I have already created some of the applications over here. Northwind dashboard. If you see the pattern which Microsoft has used, right? It's very much similar. Once it comes to your Power BI resources, you have your data source from where you can get this information. Then you have your report over here, right? Now within that report, you'll have all the information where you can go and edit these details, modify or change this information which you would want, right? And once you have finalize these components, and once you have got your resources ready over here, then you can publish it onto the dashboard, right? So as far as dashboard is concerned, this is something which is shared with the end user. Now, I can, as a user, I can go ahead and create any number of dashboards as I want, correct? And these dashboards will be different for different set of audiences. So depending upon what kind of meeting I have, depending on which kind of people I'm working with on a specific day, which customers am I meeting on that particular day. So based on that, I can go ahead and create my dashboards over here. Okay, so if you see a sample dashboard here, what is the total volume of sales being done? What is the market share? what is the sentiment analysis for it while creating it. This will be created in different set of reports, and then we can pin relevant report components onto dashboard. Can you see this? So what I can do is I can, instead of typing the queries, I can choose some of the queries, or depending upon what kind of information I want to extract, right? And this is what when I say self-service BI, this is what is self-service BI. So depending upon what filters I want to apply, depending upon what queries I want to write, all those things I can put it over here. I can specify whatever conditions I want, and whichever information fits in, right? I'll be able to see that details over here. Earlier, all these things were possible by using a lot of developer interventions. A lot of team members have to get involved. What information has to be shown, how it should be shown, correct? With Power BI, most of these questions get answered easily. As far as PL 900 is concerned, there is, I would say, the percentage is much lower. If you, there is a separate certification which is primarily targeted towards Power BI, which is DA 100, right? Any details that you need, Manish and team can provide you that information as well. When we are conducting DA 100 sessions or DA 100 certification sessions for y'all. Let's move ahead. So this was a quick look in terms of Power BI. So three important services I was mentioning about. One is Power Apps, second is Power Automate, third is Power BI. Anyone, any questions still here? That's really great. So people are understanding and enjoying this, or everybody else is sleeping. There could be two reasons for no questions. Okay, I take it in the positive way. Let's go to the fourth one. And this is what I want to focus as far as today's session is concerned. So the next and very important member that we have is Power Virtual Agents. And the reason why Microsoft had to develop this was Microsoft had a complete SDK, which is a bot framework or bot SDK. And I was lucky as part of Synergetics to be part of the initiative. And myself and my entire team, we went to Hyderabad, and there Microsoft conducted this session, right? There were people coming from US who were trying to help us with understanding what is bots, why is bot essential, right? Creating some of the custom bots, they had complete environment. So around, I'm not mistaken, around 3/4 of the day, it took us to install all the basic softwares needed, right? So pretty much hard work there for us, but end result that we achieved after all that hard work. And I would say I did not write too much of code myself. A lot of the code was being given from them. So a lot of data was being given from them. But the kind of complexity which I had to go through, I realized, boss, this is not my cup of tea. Because being a Power user, right, doing all these kind of installations, deployments, and all those things, it will be really difficult. And believe me, any step went wrong. So instead of version 1.1.2, you have got 1.1. You have to do the installation once again, right? So a lot of confusion, a lot of configuration challenges there when I was working with that. Then as time moved by, Microsoft came up with bot framework 1.6, 1.7, and the recent one that you have is bot framework 2.0. And if you, I'm not sure how many of you have done bot development earlier, Can I see raise of hands? People who have done bot development earlier? So Guru Prasad, Yasin, James. No, no, don't worry. I will not ask questions on that. Because everybody suddenly has put their hands down. Money, okay. Thank you, guys. Now, what I was trying, the reason I asked that question is, people who have done bot development earlier, they would know the kind of SDK changes which has happened from 1.1 to 2.0. And I remember myself writing some of the codes, right? And the way how these things have been progressed is, I had to junk and reinstall the entire thing all over again. I had to reinstall all the softwares again, because the older framework, the older APIs, they were no more relevant. So the speed with which the details have changed is very, very fast. And it is also necessary, because the kind of limitations or challenges that we had when the bot framework in .NET began, as compared to what industry was expecting, there was a large gap over there, right? But I would really appreciate Microsoft, the way they have done the turnaround, and developers, without too much of complaints, they have started using the new SDK. They have already written the code, right? And using that code, they are able to leverage the benefits of artificial intelligence. They are able to leverage the benefits of resources using the bot framework. Any kind of emulations that you would want to do within your environment, people have been able to do that. Now, getting into details of what is bots all about. So as far as bot is concerned, bot basically is helping us to replace a human being. As simple as that, right? So if anybody is responsible for putting our jobs in risk, is ourselves. Okay, jokes apart. So once you talk about bots over here, what we are trying to say is, some of the basic tasks like, can you help me with this information? That can you help me with that information? What is the cost of this particular product? Right, some of the basic information that people want to know about, right? That information can be, that communication can be assigned to a bot. Right, as far as bot is concerned, it will have a data source behind the scene. It will know how to take up a question, answer a question, right? Basic if else kind of conditions, right? Checking for a data source. So that is what a particular bot is supposed to do. Now, this session is not about bots. It's more about, how do I create such kind of bots by using a zero code or no code solution? Now, for doing that, you can make use of Power Virtual Agents, where you need to provide all these things or create all these resources by using a graphical interface, right? Like how I mentioned about Power BI, I mentioned about Power Automate, I mentioned about Power Apps. Same way, drag and drop resources who are over here, right? Creation of UI-based components over here. That's what is given by Power Virtual Agents. So when we are working with this Power Virtual Agent, you can integrate this Power Virtual Agent with number of other services, number of out-of-the-box components, or map it with existing custom workflows. That is your Power Automate, right? As far as the UI is concerned, bots have a different UI for itself. So as of now, I have not come across any association of Power Apps and Power Virtual Agent, because both of them are UI components, right? So once you have this Power Virtual Agent being created, you can publish it onto your Teams environment. You can associate this with your web application, and behind the scene, you can have Power Automate resources, right? So that's how you'll be able to work with this. Any of your on-premises integration, any of your communication with end users, right? AI builder or AI driven resources, all these things can be implemented easily by using your Power Virtual Agents. I already mentioned about Dataverse. I mentioned about what is the significance of it. I'll skip this for now. I already mentioned about data connectors, and I already mentioned about the significance of custom connectors. What is the options available for it? I'll skip some of these slides because we have already discussed about what is the significance of these components, and so that we can focus on the our virtual agents and look at the components inside that. So if you look at Power Virtual Agents, this is what I was mentioning about. The major focus area of Power Virtual Agent is reduced assisted support inquiries, where some of the basic information is needed by the end users, right? In terms of task automation that you want to do, these are few points. If you see the diagram over here, it talks about many more such resources. So one is improved customer interactions, right? Because once it comes to human beings, there may be a chance that you had a bad day at home, right? And that frustration comes out on the customer, which is very, very bad thing, I would say, right? But it can happen. There could be a chance, even if there's a good person or a person with right professionalism, there could be an issue that is a line or there's a queue that people have to wait for his availability. That could be an issue, right? How do you want to have a quick ROI on the implementation? Easy escalations to live agents. So some of the common things which can be taken care by the machine, by the bot, let it be taken care by that. And some of the specific requirements or specific requirements or specific cases where you think here the human intervention is required, is essential. Only in those scenarios we'll go ahead and hand it over to live agents, right? In terms of responses to customer inquiries or personalized customer interactions, right? So you would know that when to hand it over to a human being, when do we take care of a requirement by using a bot. As part of your DevOps scenarios as well, we have been stressing upon the point of automation, right? So Power Virtual Agent basically is a mechanism of automation of communication for number of human interactions, right? Once you have your data already being captured, when you have your resources already being captured, how do you make sure you get the response or utilize that data at a faster pace? That is what Power Virtual Agents can help you do. So if you look at your environment over here, I don't think there is any change in context of environment once it comes to your Power Virtual Agents. So you can go to any of your existing members over here, Power Apps or Power Automate. You have admin.powerplatform.microsoft.com, which can provide you administration details for your environment. You can take existing environment or you can create a new environment over here. Right? So your initial resource will remain same. There is creation of a new environment. Once this is being done, it will be your step one. As far as step two is concerned, this is creating a bot using a Power Virtual Agent interface. So there are two options available. One option is you can download a builder over here, right? That is Power Builder, your Power Virtual Agent Builder app, which is your bot framework version 2.0. You have an entire UI environment for that. And second environment that you see over here would be your Power Virtual Agent, which is a web-based interface, right? So today's today's session, we are going to discuss about the web-based interface over here. Once you have your environment ready, here you can look for web.powerva.microsoft.com. Okay. web.powerva.microsoft.com. This is basically your web-based solution, web-based environment over here, where you have number of components inside it. Okay. The first thing that you'll see here is your bots panel, which is, if you see the center section over here, this is your test bot panel. If you want to create a new bot, on top right corner, you have bots panel. Click on that. This will help you to create your respective bots. Right? So as part of your bots environment, here you have customer service, which was my previous bot. And second bot that you see is, which I have created, called as Synergetics bot. So any kind of communication, conversation. So since Manish and Rupesh, they are already been working and talking to number of customers, what we can do is I can relieve some of their workload, some of the basic information about the sessions and all those details. We can create a bot for it, which Manish has already done. So from my side, Manish, I'm not sure how many of you have been to our Synergetics site, synergetics-india.com. If you go there, most of this information is now available as part of the bot over there. Right. So this is our first section, that is the bot panel. You can create a bot over here just by saying new bot, specify the details that you would want. What is the environment that you would want to create over here? You can do that. If you want to create a new environment, you can do that as well. Right. This is your step one, that is using a bots panel. As far as second member is concerned, which is the settings section. So if you go to the settings section, so you have system fallback, transfer to an agent, right? These are some of the pre-existing components that you have within it. Right? So what is the option for fallback mechanism, default behavior, some of the generic properties are available here. So if you want any kind of change in how this UI should look like, what should be the option over here, right? These kind of UI settings you can do over here. Look at the other options available. We are already on the home section right now, where we can see the topics, testing of bot. Now, like we have been mentioning about communications with the user, right? Automation of communication. How do I do that? So automation of communication, you have something called as topics over here. There are plenty of existing members, which are system defined topics, right? Escalation, confirmed success, confirmed failure, goodbye, greeting, thank you, right? So some of these things are part of your existing resources, right? That is called as system based topic. Apart from that, you can you have like we discussed about templates, correct? Similarly, here you have custom templates like lesson 1, lesson 2, lesson 3. These basically are template topics which Microsoft has given to us, right? So we can utilize that. Apart from this, other options that you will see over here, that is cancel order, new order, check whether, delivery and setup, order. These are certain things. These are certain topics which I have created for the demo in this environment. And I can showcase each of these members as we go ahead. Third resource that you see over here is entities, right? So as far as common communications are concerned, some of the how do I put it? If you look at the assets that one would create in from programming terminology, if I use it, those are referred as entities over here. Entities basically are options for storing data. So some of the user inputs that you will see, which is pre-built entities over here. So along with topic, you also have some of the pre-built entities over here that one can use. And this is by default mapped to some of the common terms or common questions that people have. Right? So whatever common communication options that one would have, those things are being mapped over here. So if I'm going to use some of the components, I'm going to use some of the attributes or properties while writing my code, I'll have to while creating my Power App solution, I'll have to make sure I create all these entities over here. So if you'll see some of the properties, like some of the entities which I had created was usage types, support categories, order. So you can utilize existing identity, existing entities, or you can also go ahead and create new entities as per your requirement. And that's what I have done over here. Analytics, I don't think I will have much over here right now, because unless there are more number of hits or from your website or the way how things have been going, correct? Once there are more and more people who have used your services or who have gone to your website, invoke this bot, right? Then you will be able to see the details here. So as part of your bots, then when you're creating, you can specify that end this particular bot with a customer feedback, right? So how was the feedback? Good, bad, ugly? You can see the graph over here. Right, so this is the primary details that you have as part of your analytics resource. Now, once it comes to other resources over here, once you have done all your hard work, right? I hope by now things are clearer, to getting slowly and steadily clearer to people. Step one is creating entities that we are going to use. Second is creating topics, right? Third step over here is doing a publishing, right? So you'll say, boss, I'm done with my bot creation. I have captured all possible details which I was aware about as of now. Because as your application keeps growing complex, as you keep capturing feedback from the user, as you keep getting the questions from the user, you'll come to know slowly and steadily, apart from whatever topics you have created, what are the other things that people are asking for? What are common questions that people are asking for? So keeping that kind of requirement in mind, you will have to go ahead and keep updating your bot. So it's not like once you have done it and then you take a deep sleep. You'll have to keep updating it time and again, correct? So what will that help you do is those kind of questions, right? And you keep making note of it. That's why many organizations that you'll see, right? Banking or any kind of travel support systems or help desk kind of systems, wherever you see chatbot solutions, all the telephonic conversation that we do is recorded. There are two reasons for it, obviously. One is the quality purposes. When you're talking to a human being, what is your behavior? How is your tone? How is your communication mechanism, right? And second reason is this as well. So what are those common questions that are coming? Can I put those questions as part of the bot? So next time when the question comes, I will see which category it falls into. I will update my bot accordingly, and I will be able to, I'll have to supplement that data as well. Huh? So it's not just about asking those new questions or adding those new questions there. You have to supplement the questions also, supplement the answers for that. If the user asks this question, This is how we do. In our case, like what Rupesh and Manish are doing, these guys really have a tough time because every quarter or every month there are new sessions. So if they have to update these things within the chatbot, they will have to keep updating the data source again and again, right? But yes, that's part of the business that we are into. Similarly, whatever kind of business y'all are into, y'all have to create your entities. What are the common terms being used day in, day out, right? What will be the relevant topics or the questions that people are going to ask? You have to prepare that list of questions and then finally create a. So apart from creating it, the planning, I would say, is more critical over here. So create your entities, create respective topics for it, publish it, depending upon where you want to make it available, right? My mistake, sorry. Before publishing, make sure you test the bot over here, see how it is working. Let me go here. Okay. Let me go to greeting. And a simple message here. I've increased the font size just to make sure you're able to see this. So these are three basic options you have given to the user: order questions, delivery and setup, and weather related. Let me go to order questions. Can I help you with that? I can help you with that. What do you want to do? You want to place an order or you want to cancel the order? Okay, I want to place an order. Let me transfer your request to an agent. Human being is involved over here. Some generic information which needs to be displayed before the actual transfer happens, you can mention it here. Okay, so once this is being done, it's being transferred to a human being. So I can't show you the telephone actually going to Manish or Rupesh right now, but in real worlds, this is how it will happen. Right? So if I go for delivery and setup, what else I can assist you with? This is the primary. So there is, in all scenarios, you may not have some actions to be done. You may just show the information and your job is completed there. In third scenario, right, there can be more interaction. So how much of interactions you want to build with the user, that's up to you, right? What city do you live into? Live in. Okay. What is your postal code? You can mention those details over here. It will do the required processing. Watch for scattered rain showers. Right, so it'll show the information over here. So I mentioned city as Mumbai. It has already captured as its location is India. So I can get that details from here. Now, what I have done to make this work actually is I have modified this greeting. What did I do here? As far as this greeting is concerned, I have modified this. And if you see the trigger phases, so I've not changed the trigger place. Trigger phase remains the same, and you'll see there are so many trigger phase. Trigger phase in sense, what will trigger or initiate your communication. What I have changed over here is respective topics. And within this, I have specified I'm a virtual agent here. Tell me what questions you have. And based on the questions being asked, now this order questions, delivery and setup, whether it is, this is something which I have added. It was not there in the greeting earlier. It's not part of the system defined topic, right? And within this, based on the condition being mentioned or based on the option being selected, I'm redirecting it to pre-existing topics which I have. Okay. Now what I'm trying to mention here is whenever you are creating a complex bot or a Power Virtual Agent, you'll have to break it up correctly. You'll have to break it up correctly. So what is the first interaction that you'd want to create? Now for each of these interactions, what will be the subsequent set of activities that one would want to do? Just to share an experience, when I was creating a bot, I landed up creating a bot which is around say 10 pages. Because and after a certain point in time, it was becoming unmanageable for me. Because scrolling left, right, top, bottom, right, it becomes so haphazard. Then I realized that this is not the right way. The right way over here would be to break it up into smaller components. Like how would you do for how would you do it for your Power App, where you have a lot of complex UI to be displayed, right? So you would segregate that in terms of components. You would create layouts for it. How one would do it for Power Automate, you would create, say, flow one, invoke that from flow two, like that, correct? Or Power BI, where you create the report separately, create different reports on different pages, then you push it onto dashboard. Same way, we will have to organize these things smartly. Organize these things in such a way that it becomes reusable. And even if it doesn't become reusable, it will be still easier for you to manage those things. That's important, right? And I learned it a hard way. I would not want you all to do the same mistake, right? So please be careful. Organize yourself. Just plan correctly. What do you want to achieve? How do you want to work with it? So I was mentioning about topics, entities, right? Test bot panel, how do you work with it? Let's go to the next section over here, which is configuration of topics. So in terms of configuration of topics, here, there are, like I said earlier, there are pre-built members over here. Pre-existing system topics which are there. Apart from that, based on what is your customer's domain or what is your organization domain, you can go ahead and add relevant topics over here. If you understand it another way, topic basically is kind of an event which will initiate your bot, which will enable the communication with your bot. That's what is referred as topic. Right? So if you look at the members over here, so you have your trigger phases over here, and you have your respective conversation nodes, right? Let me show some of the sample lessons over here before I jump onto the application which I have built. Let me go to topics once again. Let me go to simple topic. So here if you see, when are you closed, when are you open, store hours, daily open hours, these are some of the pre-built topics over here or pre-built trigger phrases over here, right? If I go to authoring canvas, so depending upon the trigger phase which is being received, this will initiate itself. What do you want to show as a welcome message to the user? How do you want to showcase details over here? Now somebody may ask that all these things, can't I put it in one box? Yes, you can. No problem with that, right? And then go ahead, end the conversation. Right? So this is relevant for each of the members. Let's go to lesson two. So if you see the lesson two over here, and if I take you to the authoring canvas, there are more number of questions being asked. So I have my branches and number of locations. Which location are you interested in? Now, while we are having these interactions with the end user, okay, what I would want to do is I would want to save some of these values for future. Some of these information, I would want to save it for future. So I have accepted this value from the user. Multiple choice options, Redmond, Seattle, right? I can create a variable here. Now, once this variable value is being stored, I can reuse this value in number of places. Here, if you see pva.store location. So this value I have stored here. I'm checking, I'm using that value inside the condition. Along with that, I'm also mentioning it part of my message over here, which is pva_store location. So declare a variable, specify a type as which is the text over here. Now just imagine that if you have 10, 15 conditions, right? The size will grow pretty large in terms of horizontal sizes. So what you can do is you can organize it, group it in such a way that you can break it up into different topics, right? That's how you should be, that's how you'll be able to manage these things easily, right? So there are plenty of such lessons which are available to you, and some of the system based members is already being used here. I would recommend don't modify these contents unless you know what you're doing, unless you are aware about how and what will be the response for it. How do you want to handle these things? Now, one more thing which we looked at apart from variables. Right. So if you look at your type of computers over here. So you can go to your entities, and as part of entities, you have your country or region, continent, date, time, email address. These are some of the pre-built members over here, pre-built entities over here, which one can utilize. Let's proceed further. So as far as topic creation is concerned, so right now what I discussed was some of the pre-existing members. If you want to create a new topic for yourself, you can check for existing resources. You can mention what is the topic name that you would want, right? What is the friendly name, description, and what will be the trigger phases over here. Now, please be careful. I'm not saying take care of the spelling mistakes, right? You may not want to do that, because while creating the entities, can you see this? This is called as smart matching. So as part of smart matching, that it automatically takes care of misspellings, grammar variations, words which have similar meaning. So these things you have taken, you have already taken care by the entity, so you don't have to worry about that. So as far as topics is concerned, you can look at generic questions over here. Let me show you how I have done it. So I first already showed you for I think greeting, I already showed you, which is the initial conversation which I am building with my customer. Second thing which I have over here is order and delivery setup. So if I go to order, what is the trigger phase? The trigger phase here is order question. And as part of this topic, I have already mentioned what resources I want to create over here. What is the values of which I want to take from the user? That is place an order, cancel an order, and I have stored that value as part of the variable text. Right? And here if you see, I have redirected it to new order and cancel order. Getting everyone? So once you store the variable value, how are you going to use that variable later? You can pass that variable when you are invoking a new member here, which is new order or cancel order. Let's proceed ahead. So this is how you create a topic over here. Now, once a topic is created, for each topic, you can have number of questions and number of trigger phases. And within that trigger phase, you can specify your execution mechanism. So how will that data being processed over here? Another member which I have, like I showed, order is invoking new order and cancel order. These are simple. Make a new order, place an order. So here what I can do is I can just do transfer to an agent. Right? And once I have done transfer to the agent, this is how I want to end this communication. Right? So this is what is the trigger phase and how you can go to the authoring canvas over here. So if you look at the options for communication, one option is what I have been showing you, two options I showed you right now. One is show a message and second is ask a question. I'm not sure if we have done the third one. What is the third one? Third one is call an action, where you invoke another trigger. You invoke another topic. What am I saying? No, there's something wrong here. So show a message, we are clear. Ask a question, we are clear. Go to another topic we have seen. And this is how we have laid out things. End the conversation also we have seen, right? Where I want to transfer it to the agent. Go, call an action is something which is different. And for that, I have a beautiful example here, which I want to show you all. This is called as check whether. Okay. This is another topic which I have. And here, if you see, options available, check whether, what will it rain today, what is the weather like, today's weather. So this could be some of the trigger phases which user will mention. Now if I go to the authoring canvas here and let's check the mechanism, I need some additional information. What city do you live in, right? And when we were getting the response, can you see the options here? Multiple reveal choice question, age, city, color, continent, day and time, right? So whatever options we had, right? All that information is available here. Support categories. So whatever entities you might have created earlier, we can utilize these entities over here. Can you see this? So all that value, the list items we have mentioned in entities, and we can utilize these values over here. This is one of the options. Along with this, in this current scenario, what I have done is I have used user's entire response. Whatever user types over there, ABC, XYZ, whatever it is user types, I would want to select that over there. And once user has selected for city, for zip code, right, I want to save that response into a variable. Right. So once that value is being saved, I will invoke Power Automate. Okay. How did I do that? So here, if you see, there's something called as call an action. Call an action basically will assist you invoking a Power Automate environment. Can you see this? Create a flow, launches a Power Automate in the next window. And using this, I have already created a component called as check whether. I already have a flow over here, which is called as check whether. So if you see this. Yeah. So here, as part of my flows, if you see, there was an interaction between Power App and Power Automate, where we were taking the value from the user. Correct? Where we are taking the value from Power Apps, right? Processing that information over here. Send email via subject one, send email body. So this inputs that you see, these inputs are coming from Power App. Similarly, if you see this, here the inputs is coming from a Power Virtual Agent. And the UI over here looks very similar to your button flow, right? Mention the value for city, mention the value for zip code. Now, once you are inside Power Automate, I don't have to tell you that you can do anything that you would want. Anything in sense, you can connect to a third-party service, you can connect to your on-premises environment, you can get these values from SharePoint, files on OneDrive, Outlook, right? Wherever you would want, right? So you have access to the entire world, I would say in that way. So you can get your data from wherever you would want. And once you have got those details, what is the value that you want to return? So I want to return a value as day summary, location, chance of rain. I don't know what other values are there. Huh? Can you see this? Temperature units, night conditions, night summary, forecast days, sunrise, sunset, moon. So there are so many values available. Latitude, longitude of the location, which I have mentioned. Whatever values you want to return from here, you can do that. So once this flow is being created, the invoking member is very clear. You can check for that resource over here. Right? So once we have got the inputs over here, got the actions over here, you can go ahead, display these contents. Can you see this? So chance of a rain, city, location, zip code. So whatever details is being returned by that service, right? We'll be able to see it over here. So we can get all the details over here. And based on which variables you want to use from here, you can do that. It's not updating here. Right? This is the meaning of call and action. So show a message, ask a question, invoke a Power Automate resource, go to another topic that you want, right? And finally, end the conversation. So conversation will end by transferring it to a manual agent, a human being, or you will end with a survey where you ask the user to fill up a survey form. If you look at conditions over here, so depending upon what options you want to add, you can mention those conditions. You can get these options from entities, or you can get the entire text over here which the user is typing, right? You can specify set of values that is there available with you in your data source, right? You can use that. You can manually add a branch between conditions, right? Whatever nodes you want to create over here, right? And if you look at the branching over here, this will be the most important aspect along with the topics, obviously, where you are bifurcating on the top level. So once it comes to the options, so if as an organization, when you're providing more number of services, you'll ask the question, you want this service, that service, service A, service B, service C. Within service A, what do you want? Within service B, what are the options available? So for each sub options, you can create another topic. Are you getting it? And then jump from one topic to second topic. Right? That's what will make sense for you. Wherever you don't want, like the moment you have moved it to a agent, you can terminate your branching logic over there. In terms of integration, I already showed you this option, which is call and action. So once you do a call and action, this will invoke your resource. This will invoke the member which is available on Power Automate. As of now, there are no direct integrations available with third party vendors. In sense, like how you have data connectors and a Power app or a Power Automate can go and connect to it. There is no direct connection to bots right as of now. Right? It may happen in future, but right now it is not there. Every interaction that will happen will be via flow members. Will be via Power Automate. So once you have invoked this member, this is what I was talking about. So you can end with a survey or you can transfer it to an agent. How do you want to end the conversation over here? So ending a conversation is a predefined or pre-existing topic. Whereas when you say modifications over here, how do you use these entities or how do you use these topics within your environment? That is what will be the differentiator. As far as entities are concerned, I already mentioned about entities. So entities basically are predefined components, predefined values that you have. So based on the user inputs being given, one would want to map these resources with pre-existing entities. Now, entities, I would say simple English, these are common business terms being used. Okay, these are common business terms being used. And this will differ from domain to domain. In certain cases, Microsoft has already given you out of the box entities. So if you look at age, right? Age, Boolean, city, color. So these are set of pre-existing types that one can use. URL, zip code, speed, right? But based on your applications, in my case, I have order as a predefined entity. So place order, cancel order, right? In terms of support categories, so what is the support that people would want? Order a question, delivery setup, support category, any other information that you'd want, right? So that information will be as part of your support categories. So this is an entity which I have created on my own based on what information I may require while building a bot. And this is not pretty difficult, but as a Power user, right, who is part of that domain, he or she would know about what are the terms and terminologies being used on daily basis. If not, please ask these questions to the user, to the actual business user, saying that what are the common terms that you are used? Because if I go to a banking sector and give an example there, people would talk about, is my money credited? Is my money debited? It's not a normal English, right? Debit and credit is something which is relevant to accounting terms. Or for financial terms, there will be different set of what is the budget that you're looking for? What are the finance options that we're looking for? Right? I'm just giving some examples. So each bot that you work with will be trained or created as per the domain that it belongs to. So you'll have to use some of these business terminologies. And use in sense, you'll have to put that as part of the entities. You have to put that as part of the topics. Now, some of these things which I'm mentioning about is actually done programmatically when you are writing your code. And from there, we pick up these things by scanning a PDF or by asking the user to upload a CSV file in a specific format, right? But those things will be part of a code-based solutions. Here we are talking about no-code solutions. So some of these common terms that we are using, we will have to feed in these details ourselves. We'll have to put in that kind of effort over here. As far as variables are concerned, I already mentioned about the variables, right? So once it comes to these variables, all these variables will be helping you to save the data, save this information for future purposes. And once your content is being saved, you can use it within your number of branches that you are creating, number of other resources that you are creating. Moving on to the last section over here, which is testing of bots. In my case, I actually began testing a bot because I wanted to show how this end result looks like and then go in the reverse manner, how that associates with the greeting as a topic. Greeting as a topic associates with other topics, which is weather info, then order application, right? And then how does that relate to other topics within that, dependent topics? So I went in a reverse manner, correct? That's how you all have to start planning. So what is the end goal that you would want? I think that makes life makes the life simpler. So what is the what you want? What is the final screen that you'd want to show? Screen in a sense, the options. And then start working backwards, right? And then from topics, come to from the final topics, come to the dependent topics, then topics which is separate, which is breakup or dependency for that, and then come to entities, right? And once you have done this in the planning phase, go ahead with the implementation, right? So based on my experience, that's how it will be easier for us to work with. Analysis, I already showed you. Let me go for publishing over here. So once you're done with this, let's go ahead and publish the content. So you can now there are various divs available for it. So using that div, you can share it with your designer team. They can go ahead and add this information over there. And this is how it will look like on your environment. Right, whatever information you would want. Now, another aspect that I would want everybody to be careful about. So as far as these resources are concerned, this will be available for members within that organization. We can embed this as part of our web application or custom web app that you are creating. So it also shares you a doc type for it. You can have your Teams integration, right? Different options available for it. So you decide how do you want to publish this resource. So currently what I did is I publish it on the website. So this is what I had planned for today. I know there will be number of people who would want to learn more about it. But I'm sorry, within 2 hours, this is what I could plan and complete. We'll definitely do more sessions on this. And I would want you all to send your request. What are the other topics that you would want me to want our team to work on and help you all with that emerging topics? So I want to stop here.
I have a question about.
Yeah, please go ahead.
I am working as a system admin.
I'm sorry, I didn't get the question. Can you repeat that once again? System admin?
I am working as a system admin in my organization. Uh-huh. And I am working day-to-day activity like server health check and email ID creation and folder sharing permission and etc. So what is the which is the best platform for this type of work, so to store the data and reports?
Okay, let me repeat the point which I understood. As a system admin, you are supposed to take up the questions, perform those actions on the underlying environment, and revert back to the customer, revert back to your team, saying that the virtualization that you wanted has been done, the VM has been created, the network setting that you wanted me to change has been updated. So you'll have to perform some action on that. Am I right?
Yeah,
am
correct.
I getting it correct? So correct. In those cases, yeah. So in those cases, you'll have to, first of all, create set of scripts. Create administration scripts, and using Flow, you can execute those scripts. You can perform those actions by using a Power Automate, and then invoke this Power Automate from your environment. So if the user says, I want to update my password. I'm giving a very simple example. I want to update my password. So can you please give me two information? What was the old password? What is the new password you want? Now I would go ahead and invoke a Power Automate, and there I will pass both these values to it, and which will help me to update the password. I hope that answers your question.
Okay, thank you.
Om Prakash, this is Guru Prasad.
Yes. Yeah, Guru, tell me.
Yeah, I have a question around that only. So let's mm-hmm. say on basis of some answers or something, I want to call a REST service. So
call a REST service, okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So how I can do that?
Okay. I don't know how to answer that, but I can show you something. So here, you can look for HTTP request as part of your Flow environment, right?
Okay.
You can go ahead, specify your FTP request, invoke whichever API you would want.
Okay.
Right? And yeah. Is it a standard API?
No, that will be the API will be authenticated.
No, and, I'm not saying so... authenticated, obviously. The question I'm asking is it a pre-existing service? Say for
example, the API is pre-existing. Yeah.
Huh. So if you see, there are plenty of pre-existing services which one can invoke from here. Can you see this?
Okay.
So if it's a pre-existing service, then this is how you can go and invoke it. So any of your SFTP kind of implementations, I can go and invoke from here.
Okay.
If it is not a pre-existing service, I can go ahead and create a custom connector for it. And through custom connector, I can invoke it. Does it make sense? So there are a lot of pre-built connectors over here. So first I would recommend is check for your pre-built connectors. If your pre-built connectors can help you invoke that member. Can you see this? If you have a Swagger URL with that RESTful endpoint, invoke it through it. Specify your member over here. Whatever authentication details you want to mention, you have to mention it as part of your invocation. Does it work for you? Guru? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay.
I think Guru has left.
Sorry, Om Prakash. I got dropped. There are some internet connectivity
issues. No problem. So for REST invocations, this is how you need to do it. HTTP plus Swagger, HTTP, and there is one more. This is primarily for invoking RESTful services.
Okay.
Sorry, guys. Yeah, Rupesh. All yours.
Okay. So thank you so much once again, Om Prakash sir, for this wonderful session on introduction of Power Virtual Agent. So I'll request everyone to just pay attention for 5 more minutes. I'll quickly share some of the announcement and. So this is our upcoming, I hope my screen is visible, right? So this is our upcoming webinar series calendar for the year. I know it's a long list, but yeah, in every session we are going to announce one by one the next session. So the next certification webinar that is going to happen on AZ104, the date is 7th August. And the registration for the same you can do. We are sending the registration link in the chat box. At the same time, we also have another webinar series that is going on, that is Emerging Technology Training Series, where the next session will be on Blade Framework. So you can join us for the same. Date is 7th August only. So as I've announced it at the start, we are going to give 5 Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers to 5 lucky winners. So for that, you have to submit your feedbacks. Even if you have any question, you can mention your questions in the comment box and we'll try to answer those questions from our end. One important announcement, once again, that I hope that you all are active on LinkedIn. So there is a special campaign conducted by Microsoft. You just have to update your skills on your LinkedIn profile, or you can update your certification that you have done recently. So once you have updated your profile, then you can just submit your entry through the link, and the link is given in the feedback form. Please do check that. Once it is updated, just fill the entry form. One lucky winner could win the Microsoft. Every month, one lucky winner could win Microsoft Surface Pro laptop. So these are the points which help you to get your badge. You can follow us on all our social media platforms to get the timely updates and announcement about our upcoming events and webinars. The recording for this session, we are going to upload on our YouTube channel soon. So just do subscribe us. And do share your valuable feedbacks. All the links I'll be sharing in the chat box, please do check them. Once again, thank you so much everyone for attending this webinar. We hope to see you in the next session. Have a great weekend. Thank you.